Hi there. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever time it is. As always, happy whatever day it is. Welcome to Left Side of the Aisle. I'm Larry Erickson. I'm your host. And for the next about half hour, I'm going to be ranting away at you at things that I think are important and that you should know about. Comments, questions, reactions can always be sent to me directly. This is my personal email, Whoviating, Whoviating, at AOL.com. And if you didn't catch that, you can always go to my website, Lotus Surviving a Dark Time, and you can get the email address there, or you can leave a comment there. And finally, as always, if you do send me email, please include something in the subject line and make it clear this is not spam, and be a little patient about getting an answer, because I stink at answering email. So, with that out of the way, let's get to it. I always like to, whenever I can, start with good news, and we have some good news this week. And if you've been watching this show, if you've seen even a few of these shows, you'll probably know what the good news is going to be. 10 years ago, there was one. Now there are, in essence, 30, and soon there could be 35. On Monday, October 6th, the Supreme Court of the United States, without comment, refused to hear appeals from five states looking to have their discriminatory bans on same-sex marriage upheld by the court. Those five states, Indiana, Oklahoma, Utah, Virginia, and Wisconsin, had lost in federal circuit court, the Court of Appeals, and those courts recognized the unconstitutionality of these bans. But now the Supreme Court has refused to hear that appeal. That means it's the end of the road for these cases. They are over. These states have lost. Same-sex marriage is now legal in those five states. Same-sex marriage had already been legal in 19 states and the District of Columbia. This kicks it up to 24. What's more, it also means that these appellate decisions are binding on the other states that are in the circuits that were involved in these decisions. That covers six additional states: Colorado, Kansas, North Carolina, South Carolina, West Virginia, and Wyoming, which means that same-sex marriage is now essentially legal in 30 states. It gets better. On Tuesday, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals struck down bans on same-sex marriage in Idaho and Nevada, finding, as is virtually all other courts that have considered the matter have done, that these bans are an unconstitutional violation of rights under the 14th Amendment. The ruling, in fact, found time to ridicule an argument made by Idaho Governor Butch Otter, keep his mouth shut, that same-sex marriage makes the institution less child-centric. He claimed that allowing such marriages, quote, will lead opposite-sex couples to abuse alcohol and drugs, engage in extramarital affairs, take on demanding work schedules, and participate in time-consuming hobbies. In response to that, in a footnote, Judge Stephen Reinhart remarked that, we seriously doubt that allowing committed same-sex couples to settle down in legally recognized marriages will cause opposite-sex couples to live a life of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. The ruling will also cover three other states in the Ninth Circuit where same-sex marriage has been banned. Those are Arizona, Montana, and Alaska, which brings the total of states where same-sex marriage is or soon should be legal to 35 states and the District, again, of Columbia. Now, the fact that the Supreme Court did not take an appeal in this case does not mean that it will not take an appeal in the future. That's especially true if the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals upholds bans on same-sex marriage, as a number of observers think it's going to, because having different circuits come to different decisions on questions of constitutionality, that'll make it hard for the Supreme Court to stay out of it. But the thing is, by not taking it up now, the Supreme Court has created a new powerful momentum in favor of same-sex marriage. Because by the time, at this point, by the time it hears any appeals, thousands of same-sex couples will have gotten married under this decision. Which means that the Supreme Court would not only have to overturn all those decisions, it would have to invalidate thousands of existing marriages, which, to say the least, would create a fair amount of legal chaos. All this has led one noted legal observer, to say that the Supreme Court refusal to accept the appeal of the five states, quotes, increases the already high probability that we are headed for an eventual ruling invalidating such laws nationwide. And a nationally syndicated columnist called it, quote, another piece of evidence that the fight over same-sex marriage is effectively over in this country. I can't help but recall that more than 10 years ago, in May of 2004, I wrote of same-sex marriage, the time is coming later than we may have wished, but sooner than we may have expected. Sooner indeed, and good news indeed. Next, there's a couple of quick footnotes to that. The first is that Missouri is a state that is not affected by these court decisions or the Supreme Court action, but just hours after the Supreme Court turned away those appeals, the Attorney General of Missouri, his name is Chris Koster, signaled that the state is backing away from defending its own ban on same-sex marriage. Last week, a state judge in Missouri had ordered the state to recognize same-sex marriages legally performed in other states. In a statement on Monday, Koster referred to the Supreme Court ruling and said that the state of Missouri is obligated to respect the contracts entered into in other states. Missouri's own ban on same-sex marriage still exists, but it's under legal challenge, as in fact are the bans in all 20 of the states that have not been affected by recent court decisions. A second footnote is that the Supreme Court will only accept the case for review if at least four of the sitting justices agree to hear it. Now, if we can assume that the four more moderate members of the court, that is Ginsburg, Sotomayor, Breyer, and Kagan, voted no on hearing this, it's interesting, if frankly rather pointless, to speculate on which of the foul five, Roberts, Thomas, Scalia, Alito, and Kennedy, declined to hear the appeals, because there had to be at least two, or there would have been four in favor of hearing it. Now, Kennedy is a good guess for a no, as he has authored some decisions that are favorable to LGBT rights and same-sex rights over the years. For the other one, actually, my money is on John Roberts. Because while he's every bit as reactionary as Thomas, Scalia, and Alito, he seems to be less of an ideologue than they are, and he seems rather more concerned than any of them with how he will be viewed by history. Third footnote, a reminder, the fight is not over. The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals has been put on hold, an emergency stay issued, in fact, by Anthony Kennedy. This is not unusual if the state indicates a desire to appeal, but still, it has been put on a stay. And the other thing is that even though Wyoming's ban on same-sex marriage should be considered as invalidated by the Supreme Court's action to refuse to accept the appeal, the state of Wyoming is continuing to fight overturning the ban in court. In order to uphold the ban, the state is using the excuse that the suit in question in Wyoming is in state court, not in federal court. So in effect, Wyoming is saying the federal courts don't apply to us. All right, moving on from there to one of our regular weekly features, it's the Clown Award, given as always for meritorious stupidity. Now, you may have heard about the protests by students in a suburb of Denver, Colorado, over the attempts of their right-wing school board to water down the new advanced placement U.S. history curriculum created by the College Board and turn it into a propaganda forum for right-wing bumper stickers promoting patriotism, respect for authority, and the glories of free enterprise, while discouraging civil disorder, social strife, or disregard for the law, which actually makes me wonder how they're going to manage to cover the American Revolution. But never mind. The students, the teachers, and the parents who joined them have managed to force the school board to back down at least part way but the issue still remains live. The thing is, the principles laid down for what's called a push, Advanced Placement U.S. History, a push. The principles laid out for the A push course really have gotten the clown juices flowing. For one example, Fox News contributor Ben Carson told the audience at the Center for Security Policy's National Security Action Summit last week that the framework has an anti-American bias, one so extreme that, quoting him, "I think that most people, when they finish that course, they'll be ready to sign up for ISIS." Now, because of the possibility, however remote, that he may have been engaging in hyperbole, that possibility leaves him falling short of the standards required for the Clown Award. So this week, the big red nose goes to Pam Mazanec, a member of the State Board of Education of Colorado, who joined into the fray last week by posting on a Facebook page, which is intended to discuss issues surrounding the curriculum. She said the framework may have been conceived by people with an agenda who wanted to downplay our noble history. And as an example of that nobility, she said, and I'm quoting, "I note our slavery history. Yes, we practiced slavery, but we also ended it voluntarily at great sacrifice, while the practice continues in many countries still today. This is part of the argument that America is exceptional." Sacrifice? Now, there's only one or two possibilities. She's either referring to the Civil War, when she talks about great sacrifice, which would seem to rather undermine the voluntary part of her argument, or she's saying that slavery was such a great benefit to us as a nation and as a people that it was a great act of noble self-sacrifice on our part to do away with it, because aren't we just so good? This is a partial and incomplete list of nations that either had ended or in the process of actively dismantling slavery in their countries by the time the U.S. Civil War began. Argentina, Austria, Bolivia, Canada, Chile, Colombia, Ecuador, England, France, Greece, Haiti, Japan, Mexico, Moldavia, the Netherlands, Panama, Peru, Portugal, Prussia, Russia, Scotland, Serbia, Spain, Uruguay, and Venezuela. Exceptional seems to have lost some of its luster these days. In fact, we actually didn't ban slavery until we adopted the 13th Amendment in December of 1865. No, it was not done with the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863. First off, that only applied to the Confederacy, and there's actually a big legal question whether or not Lincoln actually had the authority to do that in the first place. But the fact remains that we did ban slavery. We only did it after dozens of other nations had already done so, and even then it took 4 years of bloody conflict and a constitutional amendment, one which Mississippi did not adopt until 1995, and then didn't get around to notifying the U.S. archivist until 2013. But it is true that slavery still exists in many places, even though it is in fact illegal everywhere. Indeed, if you allow a somewhat broader definition of slavery than being a matter of legal property, if you include forced servitude by virtue of debt, or of having been lured into a trap by false promises of work, or some other such condition, if slavery can be understood as being trapped and exploited with nowhere to go and no hope of escape, then slavery exists across the world, including, I dare say, in the United States. But that's not what Pam Mazanec means. She meant the classic bondage of one person owning another, of one person being the legal property of another person. And she thinks our record on this is so noble, so beyond that of other nations, that it proves that we are exceptional and our children should be taught to love Big Brother, of course, Uncle Sam. She is wrong, she is an ignorant buffoon, and she is a clown. And we are taking a break. And here we are back again. It's actually now time for our other regular weekly feature. It's the outrage of the week. And here we got, it's the gift that keeps on giving. I actually retired him from consideration for the Clown Award because it was just too easy a target. But here he is, storming back to seize the position of the outrage of the week. He is that beacon of buffoonery, that incubator of inanity, that epicenter of egregiousness, Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia. He recently gave a talk at Colorado Christian University, a place where, according to University President Bill Armstrong, he has more admirers than anywhere else on earth. Now, to put that praise in context, Bill Armstrong has argued that the federal accreditation of colleges is a government takeover of private colleges, an op-ed illustrated with this. And the university is among the places that have argued that making contraceptive care available to their employees through their health insurance plans is a violation of religious freedom, even though the institution will neither manage nor pay for the coverage. So Scalia was, as even the right-wing Washington Times acknowledged, preaching to the choir when he declared that separation of church and state doesn't actually mean separation of church and state, not really. Quoting him, "I think the main fight is to dissuade Americans from what these secularists are trying to persuade them to be true, that the separation of church and state means the government cannot favor religion over non-religion. That is," he went on, "utterly absurd. It's utterly absurd to think otherwise, arguing that the Constitution is only obligated to protect freedom of religion, not freedom from it." Now, this is frankly idiotic, which frankly is nothing new for Justice Skeletor. Because as others have pointed out, if there is no freedom from religion, then the government could require non-believers to pick a religion. And being forced to swear a belief in a religion in which you do not believe would seem to be a definition of violation of religious freedom. And it's outrageous that a Supreme Court justice could actually seriously propose such a thing. But here's the other thing, and this is why this is the outrage of the week. I have talked before about what I call the commons and how it's under attack by the right wing. Traditionally, the commons referred to resources held in common by a community. In fact, it was very often land, like pasture land. But the commons, as I mean it in this context, is like a philosophical commons, a social commons, of the idea of there being a public sphere in which all can participate, all have a stake, all have a part, and all have some responsibility. It's that space of socially shared and mutual duty of what is, or at least by right should be, available to all. Now, it's that idea that there are common interests and mutual responsibilities between and among all citizens simply by virtue of being in the same society. The related idea that there is a social contract between the government and the governed, that idea is what is under attack from the right, or should I say the wrong. Skeletor's claim that there is no freedom from religion guaranteed by the Constitution is part of that attack. Now, I say that even though non-believers actually have a wide range of political beliefs. Some atheists, for example, are actually quite conservative, even though atheists as a whole tend to be more liberal than the population as a whole. The point is that the net effect of claims such as his, in fact, the real purpose of such claims, is to make it legitimate to weed certain people out of full participation in society based on who you are or what you believe. And in fact, an example of this, ultimately, this is the legal basis for resisting the rights of same-sex marriage. It's the idea that you can weed some people based on, in this case, who they love, out of full participation in society. Skeletor would extend that, or I should, if I'm going to be historically accurate, should say re-extended to your beliefs about God. This is an attack on the commons. It's the same as the resistance to same-sex marriage. It is the same as the attacks on rights to vote. It is an attack on the idea, the very idea of community. And it is an outrage. All right, last for today. There's something we need to talk about. You may have heard about, you may have even seen, the editorial cartoon that appeared in the Boston Herald on October 1st. In case you haven't seen it, this is it. This is it. You need to see it in order to have the context. I mean, you know, you shouldn't just hear it described. You should actually see it so you can actually make the judgment. The cartoon was intended to satirize a recent incident about a serious breakdown in the security the Secret Service provides to the president. A breakdown serious enough that somebody got over the White House fence and actually into the White House before they were tackled. The caption says, "White House invader got farther than originally thought." And what the cartoon shows is Obama brushing his teeth while a man in the bathtub behind him taking a bath says, "Have you tried the new watermelon flavored toothpaste?" Now, if that last part made you cringe, you are a normal human being with a decent awareness of social and cultural reality. The cartoonist, a guy named Jerry Holbert, he apologized for this, saying he got the idea after finding kids' Colgate watermelon flavored toothpaste in the bathroom at his house. And he said he was, and I'm quoting him here, "completely naive or innocent to any racial connotations." For the paper's part, it said, and we're quoting, "We regret the reaction this cartoon elicited among many and apologize for it." Clearly, that was not Jerry's intent, and it certainly was not the intent of the Boston Herald. Now, the thing is, I want to take the cartoonist and even the Herald at their word. I want to take the cartoonist at his word. Even though, it makes me wonder why he would use a kid's toothpaste addressed to a grown man. And more importantly, the idea that he was so completely innocent, so completely unaware of the racial connotations of watermelon involving a black man. I find it hard to credit the idea that somebody could be that unaware of our history. But even more, I said, I want to take him at his word. So even more, the other important thing here is that these statements, these are not apologies. An apology is, I did something wrong, not, it's too bad you reacted that way. An apology is, I regret what I did, not, I regret how you reacted. Apologizing like this is actually shifting the blame. It's shifting the responsibility from the person who acts to the person who's acted upon. I mean, I was completely innocent. I didn't mean anything. It's really too bad you can't take a joke. Now, the Herald did somewhat better the next time around when apparently had a chance to, you know, sort of like vet its own apology. Newspaper spokeswoman Gwen Gage referred to the cartoon as unacceptable in its insensitivity and racial overtones. But even so, she still insisted that the paper and the cartoonist intended no such reference. Holbert also did better on his second go-around of apologies, saying, "I didn't think this all the way through, and I really did it wrong," which at least takes some responsibility for his actions, while again still insisting that he is altogether innocent of any bad intent. In fact, he was so innocent of any bad intent that when the syndicator of the cartoon contacted him before the cartoon was published and suggested that he change the toothpaste flavor from watermelon to raspberry because of the racial element of watermelon, he said he disagreed, but went along with it because that's what the syndicate wanted. Now, curiously, the syndicator itself says Holbert agreed willingly agreed with the change and happily made the change, which makes things kind of odd because now we've got two conflicting stories about this, but never mind. Because it's really important here, what's really the outrage here, what's really worse than all this, is that he could be telling the truth. He could be that blissfully ignorant, that blissfully unaware, that blissfully insulated, that he took no notice of the meaning of the words he used, no notice of the implications they carried, so blissfully ignorant of the fact of the context, even though context matters. He could be that unaware of the pokes and prods, the jokes and jabs, the slings and arrows, the daily piles of small insults that are the normal part of the lives of African Americans in our society. He could be that unaware of the protection, the insulation that his white skin provides him. He could be that unaware of his privileged position. Because, as others have said, that's part of the point of privilege. Privilege is intended, it is designed to be invisible to those who have it. Because privilege, remember, is not always about what you get. It can be about what you don't get. It's not always about what others think about you, what they assume about you. It's what they don't think about you, what they don't assume about you. I can walk down the street past a group of women and not expect to see them clutch their purses a little tighter. I can go into a store without security following me everywhere I go, or at least without them blatantly, obviously following me everywhere I go. I can walk into a fancy jewelry store in sneakers, jeans, and a t-shirt with a hole in it without having every head turned towards me and every clerk think to themselves, what are you doing here? I can flash some bling without people thinking I either stole it or that I must be a pimp. I can see a cop car behind me in my rearview mirror, and my only concern is watching the speed limit. I have never felt the need, and I am damn sure that Jerry Holbert hasn't either, never felt the need to be in the streets with a sign declaring, I am a man. That's privilege. And that privilege is not based on money. It's not based on education. It's not based on dress. It's not based on erudition. It's based on one overriding factor. This. That is what it's based on. That is privilege. And until we make an awareness of that privilege part of our everyday experience, until we stop dismissing the anger of our brothers and sisters as unimportant because we don't see the offense, what the offense is, so they should just get over it. Until that time, black parents will still have to teach their children how to avoid getting shot by cops, knowing that neither wealth nor position will protect them, and living in fear of the day, which they know will come, the day when their child is called nigger for the first but not the last time. That's it. I'm done. We're out of here. I'm going to just wrap up and just say very simply that we'll see you next week. You have the best week you possibly can. Peace.